Right, good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining us today. My name is Jamie Crossman-Smith, and I'm the Head of Data Assurance Services here at Grant Thornton. What I do on a day-to-day basis is I look after the audit analytics book here within the financial services team, and I also look after the data assurance book, which is looking at key data lineages, whether that's BCBS 239, Solvency 2, or financial crime. And I make sure that the data within those lineages is complete and accurate. My background in financial crime has gone back quite a long way. I feel old saying this, but over a decade ago, I started with doing analytics around big sanctions investigations for OFAC. And latterly, I was a regional head of financial crime, leading a first-line financial crime operations function. My background, though, is strongly data and analytics in audit, and I keep getting drawn back into it for my sins. So I haven't turned my camera on, but I'm also joined today by Chitvan Jindal. Chitvan, would you like to introduce yourself, please?
Sure. Hi, Jamie. So I work in Jamie's team as a lead for the audit and control automation work we're doing, but I have a massive specialization in analytics and financial crime. In a previous life, I was the head of financial crime analytics, or the equivalent of that role, back in New Zealand, where I helped them uplift their analytics across the board for financial crime, anti-bribery, corruption, FATCA, CRS, and a bunch of other regulatory requirements. Then moved to the UK not long ago to help Jamie out.
Thanks, Chitvan. Right, so as I said before, thanks for joining us today. So we've decided to host this webinar today because our experience with our clients across the board have seen various different practices, and we know that the regulatory burden is just going to get more and more and more, and the regulatory expectations are getting higher every day. And of course, there's a high cost in failure as well, if to meet those regulations. So in our view, organizations that can think innovatively and leverage tech may well hold the key to being front runners in the field. And today we're going to talk about some of those techs advantages that are being used and how they can help you in industry. Tech and financial crime has come a long way, but many smaller organizations are still taking a rudimentary approach in manual screening and transaction monitoring using Excel, for example.
Yeah, and as you said, Jamie, a lot of them are still working on getting that right, given the high cost of failure we've seen so far. I think it's close to almost, in the last year, I think I saw something like $25 billion in fines that have been imposed due to financial crime in just 2019. So huge, huge costs when you don't get it right. And it sounds like, a lot of them are still working on that.
And of course, for me, the main driver is right now is COVID-19, forcing us to think innovatively. And the more tech we use, the less people we use, and the less overhead there is to our firm. So it's a bit of a win-win, isn't it? And on that note, Chitvan, I know you've recently been looking at the uses of machine learning in the industry. What are your thoughts on this?
Yeah, so absolutely. So machine learning is something we've all heard of as kind of like the hot new flavor of the month when it comes to data analytics. I mean, I say month, but, years. And it's being used in a lot of different contexts across financial services and other industries as well. Definitely anti-money laundering and counter-terrorism financing is no exception to that. Although, the requirement with AML/CFD being highly, it's got a very stringent regulatory climate. And as we've mentioned, a very high cost of getting it wrong has made it an interesting challenge when it comes to machine learning. It requires whatever you output to be quite reliable in order to make sure it's effective at what it needs to do. So as a result of the high cost of failure, and I guess the organizations that have implemented, strong AML policies in place have been focused on putting in manual processes, typically having something that's quite well defined as rules for transaction monitoring, customer risk assessment or customer risk rating, and other parts of the process. And they typically put in very deterministic rule-based rules because, you can explain them, you understand them, and they can be tweaked a lot more easily. But machine learning has been, it's coming out as a brand new way of kind of changing that world to make it more effective, to reduce the effort. So when we say high cost of actual implementation, not just a failure, is because a lot of the outputs of these deterministic rule-based kind of processes tends to be a lot of false positives. And I'm going to refer to that concept a few times in today's webinar. So we've got the concept of false. You go on, Jamie.
So I was going to say, no, I think that's fair enough. So building machine models requires a lot of data, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And as you said, there's quite a lot of false positives, but not a lot of true positives.
Yeah, absolutely.
What does that mean?
So the concept of true positives and false positives kind of comes back to where if you've looked at metrics that are core to assessing the effectiveness of your transaction monitoring platform or alert generation, is where, you know, once I've had a SAR or a transaction that's been alerted, how many of those are truly instances of SAR that I will report to regulator, or how many of those are not. So a true positive is one that I do end up reporting, and a false positive is one that I don't end up reporting. So in reverse, we also have a true negative, one that, you know, I haven't picked up as an alert. And then in reverse, a false negative is one of the most riskiest, is where there was financial crime happening in that transaction and I didn't pick it up in my alert management process. So as you can imagine, in order for us to build machine learning models, we need data across all four categories to be able to build something effective. And this is a challenge, particularly in transaction monitoring, because as you can imagine, there's not a lot of true positive data out there for us to use, especially in a single organization. I mean, I can't imagine an organization that would be picking up a lot of their transactions as being true hits, or even the ones that are being alerted, how many as a proportion are being true positive.
Well, I think I was going to say, Chitvan, I think in terms of sanction screening, most of the organizations we work with, you'll be lucky if you get one alert a year, if that's one true positive alert. Yep. Absolutely. Transaction monitoring, obviously, you're going to have a lot more, but that's dependent on the risk appetite of your business and what sort of AML models that you've seen.
And absolutely, it does come down to the risk profile of the bank or the organization itself and how they kind of structure what they're looking for. And the problem with, I guess, not having enough data is that you end up with a bias. So for those that were on Jamie's chat last week on demystifying AI and machine learning, he did a demo with, say, income data, and you would have seen that there was a big bias in his source data, where he had a lot of customers who were in one particular category of the data opposed to the other category, which was, I think, much, much smaller, which led to his model not being as accurate as possibly could have been. So that's a challenge, yeah.
So I was going to say, so playing all that back, I mean, as I said before, we know ML models require a lot of data, and we know that for most organizations, there's going to be an awful lot of false positive data, but not much true positive data.
That's the thing.
So how can organizations really leverage machine learning with all that false positive data and very little true positive data?
So what we're seeing recently is the regulators and even industries are getting smarter about this. And there's been initiatives, to kind of bring it all together. It's, you know, whether it's banks sharing data with each other, or central NGOs type of being set up, or industry platforms being set up to share some more information about activities in the market that might be fin crime, so they could all implement that data more effectively. And more data means more effective machine learning, which means that overall we actually get far more true positive hits than we've ever got in the past, right? So there is some activity doing that, but this is part of the challenge of implementing machine learning, is having some good high quality data available to yourself as an organization to be able to leverage to build that model up as well. But in the interim, what we're seeing is that there's a lot more of the machine learning being used in other parts of things like ID&V and customer risk rating, which we'll talk about in a second as well.
Yeah, and I think that's a really good point. So, you know, building out the utopia of having basically organizations working together, sharing data and that will allow them to leverage machine learning a lot more, because they'll have a lot more true positive data. And what we're seeing, what we're starting to see, is organizations starting to, particularly big organizations, starting to realize that they can certainly leverage false positive information in machine learning by saying, right, okay, I can quite accurately work out what an obvious false positive is, and I can knock that out straight away.
Yeah.
So it didn't. So it sounds quite counterintuitive that I'm going to use a technology not to find the true positives. I'm actually going to use it to find the false positives, which is, every bum on a seat in an operations function is a cost. So the more you can knock out, the better. So I guess, Chitvan, and I mean, I know you've touched briefly on the regulatory implications of all of this, in terms of, you know, looking towards sharing some of this data. Is there anything else the regulators are doing in this area?
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, as you can imagine, with sharing data, there's massive implications of GDPR and stuff that are still being considered. But when it comes to the FCA in the UK doing something, they've recently set up a fintech sandbox to allow for more and more initiatives to be tested out. I mean, the regulatory is very pragmatic. They understand that there is a high cost to it, and they are, you know, not really moving on the requirement of the effectiveness of whatever AML policies and processes get put into place, but they are willing to, you know, they are keen to have these organizations try out innovative ideas, new technologies to figure out how to make it more efficient and likely more effective as part of the effort as well. You know, so a machine learning model that does transaction monitoring, if it's more effective at being able to pick up new emerging trends and transaction patterns to be able to figure out, you know, where financial crime activity or terrorism financing is happening, that's obviously a win for everybody at the end of the day. And if it reduces cost, why not, right?
Yeah, agreed. I mean, one of the big bars I've seen is the quality of data that organizations have. Yes. It's not always just about, you know, how do I get the tech in? How do I use the tech? Which experts do I have that can help me with this? It's just about that you've got to fix the basics first. So in terms of the barriers to entry to using machine learning in work and alerts, can you give us some more information on what they may be?
Yeah, I think you're going to see a very common trend in the conversation we have today, but also I guess in a lot of conversations that, you know, we tend to have, you and I, Jamie, with our clients, is that the better your data quality, the more you enable yourself to do. And, you know, using some of the modern technologies available to yourself is really dependent on how quality your data is. So for machine learning models, they're quite sensitive to, I guess, the bias and the quality of the data. So if you are, for example, missing date of birth in a large proportion of your customer base, there's a lot that actually may have an influence for in terms of your AML policy. So, you know, something as simple as payment screening, not even using machine learning, isn't going to be as effective for you. Well, it will be effective, but you're going to have a lot more false positives come through without date of birth with your payment screening than you will if you had date of birth and your data accurately captured for every customer as well. So data quality is such a critical part of being able to do some of the machine learning more effectively. Now, Jamie, I understand that some of the other work that is also being looked at right now is graphical network analysis that you've been looking into. Can you share a bit more about that with us?
Yeah, graphical network analysis sounds really complicated. It sounds like the domain of a PhD in maths like last week, but it really isn't. So for those of you on the call, a graphical network analysis is, think about Facebook, and I'm sure you've seen all those diagrams where you can show all the interconnectedness of people by their friendship circles. So, you know, the blobs represent the people and the lines introduce the friendship links. And that's what graphical network analysis is. It's pulling those graphs together. And the key concept is the node in graphical network analysis. And the node is the person, typically, if you would apply to AML. And the edge, which is the second main concept, is the relationship between them. And of course, that relationship can be either, you know, very strong relationships. For example, it could be a husband and wife relationship. It could be a business partner relationship. It could be somebody who lives at the same address, or it could be quite a weak relationship. It could be somebody who's done a number of transactions with a particular individual over a period of time. Doesn't mean that they are closely related in some way. But being able to graph all that out is really important. And I can't remember the term that they used in Facebook, but I think if you look at everybody's Facebook friends, for example, you'll work out that everybody is connected to each other by six people, Chitvan?
Yeah, I think the term that I remember it being called is the 6 degrees of separation. Back home where I come from, we used to call it 2 degrees of separation because New Zealand's such a small place that everybody's only two people apart from each other. So it sounds like what you've been doing, this network analysis stuff, is kind of like being able to link your people to your accounts then to the corporations and businesses they might also be, you know, sending and receiving money from as well. Does that sound about right?
Yeah, correct. So that is right. So although it is technologically complex, you know, data scientists have made this quite easy. So there's tools out there that are thankfully open source, which means free, that can help us with it. And they're relatively simple to use. But they do have a relatively big bar to entry in terms of having to upskill and learn new languages. So there are Python libraries out there, such as NetworkX and graph databases, which help store this information in a non-relational form like Neo4j. They're all open source, they're all free to use. But if you said to a data scientist who's never had experience using say a graph database before, it would be a steep learning curve, but not insurmountable. But the benefits are quite significant ultimately. Yes. At the end of the day.
So this kind of all sounds quite relevant, right? Like it sounds like a bit of a no-brainer. Could you kind of compare that to what other banks doing today in this space?
Well, I'll flip that on its head a bit. So I'll say, for example, imagine you're working an alert in an organization and you're trying to work out, you've worked out that this is dodgy and a SAR needs to be raised, and you're then therefore taking this the second step to see, you know, how much has that impacted the rest of my organization? Is there anything else I should be aware of? Imagine being able to pull up a screen with that shows a graphical network that shows all the people and the strengths of those relationships. And I take it, I guess you could even take it one step forward and risk rate it formally. And that'll give you a targeted view and of where you should look next for where that money laundering ring or whatever may stretch to. Mm-hmm. So it is really useful. And where we've seen this work really well is in some organizations where they're using it for customer onboarding. So you want to open a current account, say, for example, but I work for a bank and I realize that I've been hit by numerous different fraud rings. So I take my new customer's data and I work out where I've seen that information before, whether it could be a telephone number, because we all know they're good at recycling telephone numbers, could be an address, could be, who knows? But being able to take all that data they have in it about an individual, an IP address, whatever else, and be able to see where they've seen that data before and the strength of that relationship and therefore the risk to that on onboarding that customer would be a significant plus in my view.
Yeah. So am I relatively correct in kind of assuming that, you know, along with what I said earlier, data quality is quite a central requirement for a lot of these things as well? So similar to machine learning, where, you know, you need to have strong data quality and strong data on your customers to do some of this stuff?
Yes. And let's be honest, it's a regulatory expectation anyway. If you want to do good customer due diligence, you've got to get the data on your customer to be able to do that. But having it, it's taking it one step forward to make sure it's in a consistent format. Most databases have that. So, but it's really important that if you're a smaller organization, to make sure you have all that data that you need to be able to do this in a consistent format. So, I mean, that is a really good example of how tech can be used to improve onboarding. Chitvan, is there any way machine learning could be used to in that space or used to augment this at all?
Yeah, absolutely. So we're going to talk about some other use cases of, you know, more smarts in onboarding around ID and V and in a second. But the area that I want to kind of talk about first is machine learning for customer risk assessment. So I mentioned earlier that, you know, alongside using it for transaction monitoring and things like alerts management, we could actually use it quite effectively for customer risk rating. So if you think about how customer risk rating works today, it's very much, again, a rule-based logic set, so deterministic. You have a customer that, you know, is from certain high-risk countries, and you give them a number of points based on that. You have customers with certain attributes, like, say, they're cash-heavy industry, and you give them more points for that. You add up all of those individual points for those different attributes. You come up with an overall point, and if that, you know, points for that customer is over a threshold, then you rank them as a high-risk customer. If they're under a threshold, then you give them a lower risk rating appropriately. The challenge with that is that in order to update your rule-based logic actively, you have to be very, you know, you have to constantly assess what the impact of every change will be on the customer's risk assessment, right? Because you don't want, if you have too many high-risk customers, you have to put them all through enhanced due diligence, you know, too few, and you may not pick up the relevant ones that you need to under the eyes of the regulator as well. So what we're seeing now is, you know, an uptick in the use of machine learning to help us, again, reduce the number of or make our high-risk customers be the ones that we really need to care about based on both our transaction monitoring activity, our alerts, but also SARs and stuff we're generating. So using what we call a reinforcement learning model, where we basically give it a job of maximizing or reducing something. So give it a reward that it's aiming for, right? So here we can say that we want to maximize the likelihood of a true positive or reduce the likelihood of a false negative, right? Or even reduce the number of false positives overall.
So this doesn't sound too dissimilar to a piece of work we did a year or two back around credit decisioning.
No, it really isn't. So, I mean, customer risk assessment, you can honestly completely align with what happens in credit decisioning. So there's the goal of setting a credit scoring for a client that's based on, you know, reducing the likelihood of them defaulting. And then if they are, the higher likelihood they are of defaulting or being a bad debtor, then, you know, you may not give them a loan or you may choose to give them a higher interest rate. It's not, you know, hugely different from that. The challenge, though, in a lot of this comes in from the explainability of it all. So the machine learning models, essentially, they kind of are ones and zeros in the background, right? We don't program them with any specific code, per se. They kind of build up that logic on their own. And behind it all, we can't decipher that very easily. So what we're seeing an uptick of is this explainability of AI. So that's where you have another machine learning model that sits on top of your core model to kind of help you understand what are the thresholds that it's setting for different parameters to be able to actually get the outcome you're after. And when it explains that is what you actually implement in your practical platform. But that way you can kind of meet the regulatory requirements. So for example, we've got the fourth money laundering directive, which kind of requires us to have explainability behind our risk rating decisions. And so it's quite important that we keep that explainability all the way through. The same thing goes for credit decisioning. So you're absolutely right. It is heavily aligned with what happens there as well.
So you're telling us that you would explain one machine learning model with another machine learning model?
Absolutely. It sounds funny, but that's exactly what we have to do. And that's what is happening in credit decisioning today as well with a number of the large banks out there. So it's very interesting. But the key thing here is that you really do have to kind of paired with a strong human-driven QA. So what you can't do is completely rely on the machine learning model to kind of just do it all on its own. So you have to pair it with, you know, an ongoing QA activity where you're monitoring what its outputs are, aligned with what, you know, you're expecting to see, and making sure that if any time that it kind of goes off the rails or whatever, you don't, you know, you let it kind of pull it back a little bit, or you correct the thing that's causing to happen, because it all, like I said, comes back to quality data. And, you know, bad quality data into the model or even a bias in the data could cause it to go a little bit off track if you're not sure about what's happening on the back end there.
I think Chitvan, that's really fascinating. If I play this back to my audit experience, for example, mm-hmm. I would always look at proving a machine learning model is and treating it like a black box in a way. Mm-hmm. You have a set of inputs, you have a set of outputs. We don't know what happens in the middle, just the same as you wouldn't know what happens in the middle with a proprietary application you've bought off the shelf. But having a look at those outputs and makes you, and they are aligned to, they've got a reasonableness check around them. They're aligned to what you think. And if they're not, there's an understanding of that. So that, you know, without the formal term, that reinforces your understanding of the learning that it takes. Is probably the approach that we take. But it's interesting to think that, you know, even the world of audit in a few years' time might be looking at using machine learning to prove other machine learning models. And I'll look forward to, as a techie, to playing with that.
It'll be a crazy new world at one point, I reckon. Yeah.
I think what you've told us is really interesting. And with my financial crime hat on, it feels like this is very much pattern-based customer risk as assessments rather than opposed to attribute-based. So, you know, once upon a time, we would have looked at a risk assessment to say, right, does this person live in a particularly dodgy jurisdiction, et cetera, et cetera. And now you're telling me you can build up a picture based on their patterns to inform their risk.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you'll find that a lot of the tools we talk about today really come in their own when you actually combine them all together. They're not, you know, the advancements when it comes to machine learning and any kind of financial crime technology is around, you know, solving small problems, but the real benefit is when you really bring them together. So when you think about some of the stuff you've talked about, Jamie, around graphical network analysis, pairing that with machine learning models to understand relationships, understand transactional behavior in a far more effective way than a single person ever could. So, you know, think about machine learning as being one single hive mind kind of behind it all, or learning about every transaction pattern that's happening in your bank, learning about, you know, what are all the different financial crime activities it's seeing across both your bank and potentially even other banks when we start being able to share data around what's happening as well. It could become quite a powerful tool around fighting what is, you know, a huge harm to our society. But, you know, right now it doesn't happen because there is a really, really large cost to it all. Sorry, do you have a question there?
Yeah. No. Yeah. I was just going to say, I think this is another example where data scientists are going to become, you know, the true AML alert workers in the future almost, aren't they?
Yeah, absolutely. I think they're slowly taking over a lot of our industries, you know, because it is a large advantage in being able to make things more consistent, make things more reliable, yeah. Make things more efficient, lots of benefits to them all. Now, on the topic of reducing costs across the board, I understand, Jamie, we've also, you know, been looking at RPA for some of the fin crime activity like alert working as well. Well, what have you seen recently?
Yeah, so for those of you that tuned in last week and saw the demo of RPA that we've used at Grant Thornton previously, you know, you should have a good understanding of where RPA is now. But for those that didn't see it, it's basically, and if you don't know what RPA is, it's basically a big macro. So think about, you know, when you do and use an Excel, you might record a macro so that it can be repeated. And RPA works exactly the same way, but across your desktop. So if you've got access to an application, your RPA macro, essentially. You can open that application. If you want to have a look at, say, what's on the internet and search for particular terms, your RPA macro can go and get that information and scrape it off the internet. So all those jobs that were time intensive and person heavy can now be automated using RPA. And of course, RPA, you know, doesn't have bad days, isn't in a lockdown right now, doesn't turn up to work with a hangover, doesn't have a bad day in any other way. You know, you're going to get consistent results. And I'll go on to the problems with RPA in a moment. But I think if we take that back to, you know, the traditional way of working alerts within a financial crime organization, you've got level one, level two, level three. Okay. So level one is all about, you know, kicking out the false positives, kicking those false positives out. So an operator, an analyst might go on the internet, scrape some information, as I've said before, do a Google search, have a look at the account, understand more about that customer, check it against some databases, try and discount that alert on some really, really clear key factors, whether that's the date of birth or whatever. RPA can do that. So think about how much time is being used discounting level one alerts in your organization, and think about, you know, is it worth creating a bot to be able to do that? And again, one of the key things to remember is it doesn't have to be the whole process that's automated. It has to be just some of the process. Every 5-10 minutes of a process that you automate, you know, you are saving FTE. Simple. You're not just saving FTE, as I said before, you know, you're making sure the consistency is there. Now, there is problems with RPA. And the way I think about it, again, from an auditor point of view, is it's just a computer program. And in the same way that if you were to bring any computer program into an organization, you would test it, and you've got to make sure that RPA is tested and understood before you run it in live.
So it sounds a lot like RPA is really good at being able to kind of help the computer focus on what it can do best. So, you know, people can focus on what they do best, or your staff can, right? So, you know, the cognitive decision making happening, the hard stuff is what the people can focus on, and the easy stuff is what the computer kind of picks up.
Nobody wants to troll information databases. Imagine being that, you know, that level one or even level two alert worker and having all that information in one place on one screen ready to go to make that subjective decision. RPA can do that for you.
Yeah. So given, you know, it sounds pretty relevant to what we're looking at as well. So what are some of the barriers to entry around implementing RPA in a company? Right. So why isn't everybody already using it today?
Well, firstly, I think there's the first thing to remember is people are scared of what they don't know. Okay. And especially in old legacy type organizations, big old banks, you know, they've got a workforce to manage. It's difficult managing a workforce. Actually, any HR department will tell you it's difficult to manage that. And this is new technology that people aren't necessarily aware of. You know, and there's a significant amount of reputational damage, first of all, from replacing people with robots for a start. So you've got to bring all that into the mix. The second thing is getting the investment to be able to do this. It isn't that expensive. It isn't that expensive to buy a license. What's more expensive is building something, testing something, getting that through your IT cycle, and then making sure that, as I said at the very start, there's no barriers to it operating properly by making sure that if it doesn't know how to deal with something, it spits it out to an exception queue. And that's probably one of the most important controls in RPA that you can implement. If you don't know how it works, if you don't know how to deal with it, spit it out to an exception queue. The big ticket RPA tools out there all have things like artificial intelligence, machine learning built into them. So they can make some subjective decisions, but that can be dangerous. So if you were thinking about putting this into your organization to save some time, yes, it's relatively simple to do, but you've got to make sure it's implemented properly as if it were an external piece of software. And for goodness sake, don't let it go off and doing its own thing and make decisions. if you're not sure if it's out of the norm, just like a macro, it needs to almost error, not quite error. It needs to spit it out to an exceptions queue. Might sound scary, but if you think you've worked 1,000 alerts and you've got 10 in an exceptions queue, think of the savings. Fantastic.
Yeah. Okay. On that note, let's jump on to the next part of our conversation today, Jamie, around IDNV. So we've been talking a lot about the use of, you know, machine learning across transaction monitoring and alert management, graphical network analysis, but obviously there's a lot more that's going into IDNV at the moment as well to help reduce some of the effort around that. So again, we come back to that concept of reducing either the cost of, you know, complying with regulation or avoiding those large fines on the other side of it as well.
So I'll pass on to you in blockchain in a minute, but if we do the bottom bit first around passport and document validation. So one of the best things about working for Grant Thornton is the fact that we see an entire spectrum of organizations. We will see organizations that are using some of the new ID verification tools like Jumio or Onfido, and we will see some of the organizations that are still requiring, you know, physical copies of passports or copy or certified copies of passports. There is a full spectrum there. It is under, for those of you that don't know what passport and document validation is, there are tools out there that will allow you to take a selfie video essentially and hold up your passport, and it will check your face matches the face on the passport. You know that it's you, obviously, because you're doing a video. It's not just a picture and it's come from your email. And it will check all the information that's on that passport and make sure that it is correct. So where there are tools like Dow Jones or Thomson Reuters, where you could type the passport number in at the bottom and, you know, the little bar at the bottom and check that it was correct. This looks at the whole spectrum of fraudulent indicators within a passport and checks for them comprehensively. And I mean, I think there's about 300 of them, and it can do that. Fantastic. Mm-hmm. Although it does very much heavily rely on machine learning. So you'll find that some of the older players in the market are much more successful than some of the younger players in the market. So that experience, the chance that the chance for those machine learning algorithms to learn what a good face, what a face looks like and how that matches a video, you know, it takes time to build that up.
Go on. I was just going to say, like in my previous life as well, I remember we used to, and every time we had a new fraud indicator identified with IDs or passports or something, we had to, you know, put together a quick update to our frontline staff and email all of them saying, look, this is a brand new fraudulent indicator. You know, we use it for notes, for passports, for documents, and said, if you see this little thing, then it's likely to be fraud and do not accept that document, et cetera, et cetera. And that was such a painful process because, you know, it relied on our staff reading the email. It then relied on them being understanding it well enough to then actually start looking up for it, you know, and a lot of factors. But it sounds like with the use of technology behind this, you kind of reduce that risk, because the second you find something as a new indicator for fraud or fraudulent document, you can kind of upload that to the machine and have it start looking at that stuff almost instantly across the network, right?
Yeah, exactly. And I mean, don't quote me on the number. Yeah. I think it is about 300 checks that the 300 fraudulent indicators. But, you know, there's no way a human being could even justify spending the time checking 300 things on a passport before we send it through. So the fact that, you know, this has to improve quality of outcome. Yeah. Now, the problem comes with some of the smaller players in the field. You know, they haven't necessarily got the experience, their algorithms haven't learned. We worked with one organization that quite rightly did the right thing and tested this before they put it in, changed the picture on a passport to the picture of an animal, and changed the name, and guess what, it came up as a pass. So making sure that you test these things is critical. But, you know, again, it's one of those things where tech can really pay off.
I was going to add in, so like on the topic of where the tech kind of really pays off. I remember when I first moved to the UK, right? I signed up to I'm not going to name the bank, but a fintech startup bank, a very well loved fintech startup bank, and the process of signing up to that bank, and they use pretty much this electronic method of onboarding me, right? So I took a photo of my passport, I took a video of myself, I uploaded, and I think within 5 or 10 minutes, I was fully verified to use the account. In fact, my card was already loaded up on my phone as an Apple Pay card, so I could, you know, transact on the card pretty much instantly if I deposit some cash electronically into the account. Now, I also then signed up to a high street bank in the UK when I arrived, and that process took nearly 3 weeks and required me to go into a branch, hand over my documentation, have it all viewed and scanned, you know, cited by a staff member, scanned up into their system, and then I think a couple of days later is when the verification properly came through and I could actually use my account. So the difference in experience was wild. I was so impressed, right? And this is just by using what is starting to become quite a common technology now.
You know, and I think that's a fair point. What I see quite often in financial crime in particular is no one organization, none of the older organizations wants to stick the head above the parapet, you'd say proverbially, and be different from everybody else.
Yep.
So there's some comfort in being together. You know, at the end of the day, if it all goes wrong, you're all going to be in the dock together, and it's just going to, who's going to be get the biggest fine. But some of these new technologies are worth looking at, because actually, you know what? I know it's different, but it's going to give you significantly better assurance if you can wrap it in the right process with a around it.
And I'll add in that, you know, if you capture that data electronically versus a human process, your data quality takes a massive uplift as well. And
exactly.
Everybody on the call must be just thinking the only thing Chitvan keeps mentioning is data quality. I'll be honest, I'm a big stickler for that. I'm massive, like Jamie keeps reading this after we go on client engagements. I always get the feedback of he's too passionate about data, and I'll emphasize the word too passionate. So, you know, that's something that I'm definitely quite keen on making sure all the organizations we work with get right. So with, you know, and I'll emphasize, like, with validation on electronic use of passport or document collection, you do have higher quality data because you know that technology rarely or doesn't make mistakes, at least at a lower rate than your human based process might. Would you agree, Jamie? No. Yeah.
Oh, I totally agree. And you know, there's very few of us that get work pleasure out of ensuring data quality and reconciling. So we'll tie you with that brush.
Yeah.
But never mind. So moving on to blockchain anyway. Chitvan, I know you've done some work in the past, in your previous life, around blockchain, and you, as I said last week in the webinar, you were the one who taught me all of this. So can you help us understand a little bit more about blockchain, first of all, and how it's being used, or how it potentially can be used in ID&B?
No, well, you say I worked, and it was very much not a proof concept, more a head in the clouds type of thinking we were doing around how do we leverage, you know, blockchain more effectively. And one of the ideas, I mean, there was multiple different projects going on at the time, but the ones that we were really focusing on, in my area at least, was around the KYC concept, right? So like we've just discussed, with collection of identification for your client can be sometimes quite a painful process. It still requires them to give you basically a physical object, whether you give the bank your physical object by, you know, virtual means through an app or something, or a physical means by going into a branch. It still requires you to give them something that is your ID. Right? Blockchain is this beautiful concept. And again, if you were in Jamie's call last week, you've learned the concept of blockchain, but I'll summarize that very quickly. But essentially, it's the concept where there's a central database where everybody that's, you know, on the network, if you will, is writing to. And every time somebody writes to that database, they basically encrypt it, or add a key nick on the end of it, like some sort of signature saying that up to here we've written, you know, X number transaction, or here's a detail we've written up to here. And every time somebody new or a new transaction or record is added onto it, you sign it once more. So what it stops anybody from doing is going back in the history of that database and ever changing any of the data, because that would change the signature at the very bottom of it and mean that, you know, somebody's tampered with the data itself. And if you wanted to change, you know, anything in the middle, you'd have to change every subsequent signature, because each signature is also comprised of the signatures before it as well. So it becomes a huge effort if you actually ever want to change any of the data prior to what you're actually adding onto it. And the concept of that is called immutability, which means that the data is essentially not changeable. And that's really important when it comes to the likes of cryptocurrencies. But when it comes to being able to do it for, say, in our use case here, ID&V, it becomes, you know, really, really powerful, because what our clients can do is kind of, once they sign up to one organization, that organization can publish their data onto this blockchain, right? And once that client's data is up there, the next organization they might sign up to can also publish it, up until there's enough confidence in that person's data on the blockchain to then be used for the next organization to just simply be able to read from the blockchain instead of having to go and get any data from the client themselves. Meaning that what they've actually read from blockchain is verified by the individual organizations that are allowed to publish to that blockchain as well, and then have quite a high degree of confidence in what they've received about the client.
So here's a question for you, Chitvan. How would a person stop just any financial services or organization from getting access to their data?
Yeah, really relevant in the world of GDPR. I mean, you'd hope that you could trust every organization to be reliable, right? And nobody goes away and just kind of reads my data without asking, but I'm sure there would always be one or two there. But the way you do it is by looking at how can we give these clients a password, if you will, an encryption key. So each person would own their own encryption key. And that's, you know, the mechanisms behind that could be whether they log into some sort of third-party website where they can generate a key, which they give to the organization they want to give access to their data for, or even just a key on an app, or even like a little token. There's lots of different solutions, or a password that the person has to know themselves. Or something like an ID card number. Any of those could work as an encryption key, which means that the organization would have to have that number or password to be able to decrypt your information on the blockchain. And that kind of protects your data from being accessed by the wrong parties. Well, writing to the blockchain would not necessarily be locked. One of the advantages I didn't talk about as well is, if you update your address, right now, imagine the number of different banks and different companies you have to go and tell that you've just, I'm actually moving on Saturday. I mean, barring COVID-19, it's a whole thing. I'm not going to go into details of it, but I'm moving on Saturday and I made a list of how many places I have to update my address. And I think I got to about 40 places, 40 companies. And, the concept of having a blockchain means that if I change it potentially at one organization, it should then trigger all the other organizations that have access to my data to pick up on that change and either contact me to confirm it or automatically update my data on their platforms as well.
This comes together quite nicely for me. I mean, there's been plenty of conversations in the past about having central data agencies that own and look after your data, mm-hmm. rather than giving out to multiple institutions and then them having to comply with GDPR for marketing purposes or whatever else, because there'll be conflicts between the two. So I guess that this also applies not just to make your life easier and to make sure you comply with GDPR, but the concept of having, say, a central data agency that can perform ID&V, verify you, and then how would that work in terms of disseminating the information out to individuals? Would it be sending blocks, or how would that work, Chitvan?
I mean, in the perfect world, I wouldn't envisage like a central, body that owns any of this data. This would be very much an open platform. So think about kind of like open banking, where it's like a governmental initiative to have open up the data for other institutions to access your financial data through banks and stuff. In the blockchain world, it would kind of be open source. For those familiar with open source, it's kind of where the community builds something up. And what that enables is that, it kind of removes the barrier to entry as well. There's almost no cost for a new organization to sign up to it. If it's done, in the right way, then it's pretty secure. It's not pretty secure. It's extremely secure to a point where it's almost uncrackable, which means, like blockchain, like Bitcoin or other blockchain currency or cryptocurrencies, they're near next to impossible to hack, right? So a lot of the advantages to it by having it completely decentralized mean that we're a lot more protected as well when it comes to things like GDPR, because the data is highly secure. So it's something that I'm quite excited about, and I've seen some projects on it. So I've heard that I believe IBM is currently running a project called Shared Corporate KYC. And there's a few banks that are participating in that as part of being able to build up a blockchain of KYC. And they're not the only one. So I'm really, really keen to see what happens in this space in next year or the next couple of years as well.
Working with you makes me feel old, Chitvan, I've got to say. This just reminds me of when I used to help my dad sort out the VCR when it broke as a kid. Yeah, and I had to go through all those menus because he couldn't figure it out. This is it.
Yeah.
Should we trip onto the next slide then, and I'll give you a little bit of an overview of Ripple, if that's all right?
I was going to say, because we've got a minute left, Jamie, before we have to take questions. So if you want to do a summary of the next slide, and then we'll jump over to questions. If anybody does have questions, please feel free to share them in the chat function, and we'll pick up questions as they kind of come along as well.
Good stuff, thanks. Right, so blockchain is useful, is gonna be more and more prevalent, we think, in payment messaging. So for those of you that have heard of the currency Ripple, it is actually being used as part of a real-time gross settlement system. So if you wanted to send money internationally, say using SWIFT, for example, that's a centralized system where a message would go between banks and the money would follow later. A blockchain allows you to be able to send in Ripple, allows you to be able to send that information almost instantaneously within 3 or 4 seconds. It's a lot cheaper to do, so it saves banks £2 or £3 on each transaction, and it's out there already. So, and there's lots of bad stuff in the press around cryptocurrencies, and I guess for those of you that are MLROs or financial crime risk specialists, you'll probably have an allergic reaction, because we know anything to do with crypto is probably banned in your organization. but there are some good uses for it. So Ripple Labs has I won't comment, but it, you know, because I don't know, but I know it's got some corporate governance around it, at least. Might be good, might be bad, don't know. There is some there, unlike the rest of the cryptocurrencies. And Ripple is being used by some of the big institutions at the moment. So Santander, American Express, to name two. There are more that are starting to use Ripple to process global payments. It's cheaper, it's faster, and actually it gives you best execution because all that information is in those blocks in the chain. I want to send GBP and I want to get USD. I'm going to, through the advanced technology that Chitvan, you'll know a lot more about me than this one. What you'll find is you'll find that FX conversion, when it gets to the other side, is done in near real time at best execution as well. So there's, you know, it's one for the future to think about this, you know, and making sure that you know how these new technologies, you know, will affect our industry in the years to come. So thanks, Chitvan. Have we got any questions yet? Go on.
Yeah, while we're waiting on questions, so please ask questions if you have any. And while waiting on some, I'll just add on to, I guess, based on my previous point around cryptocurrencies and your webinar previously as well, one of the big advantages, you know, the difference between Ripple and, say, Bitcoin, if you're worried about it, and the reasons that Bitcoin is not liked by a lot of regulators is because of the anonymous nature of it. So, and there's also a bigger picture around the decentralization of currency and, you know, et cetera. But with FinCrime, one of, you know, the reasons that Bitcoin is well hated, and I'm not a big proponent of either, is because the wallets, I guess, the where the money is coming from and going is completely anonymized in Bitcoin. So you don't know who it comes from, you don't know who it goes to. Beauty is you can actually see money moving from one wallet to the other. So you can actually publicly see every single transaction on the Bitcoin network. What you can't see is who's doing the transaction, right? It's all completely just a bunch of characters and numbers. But I believe Ripple is implementing something very similar to Bitcoin, but the detail behind the wallet, you know, that's completely known to Ripple and other parties as well, right? So that's also public information, which is where the power comes in, because you know who's doing the transaction. It becomes a lot more able to be regulated. You can actually track all the transaction through appropriately as well.
So I guess our message is, you know, look into the future, don't try not to have an allergic reaction to the word cryptocurrency, because there's some good uses out there. So while I can't believe we've got no questions, which I suppose lets us off the hook a little bit. In the meantime, should we go through some of the cases where we've some of the work,
Jamie,
that we've been doing recently? Go on.
There.
This is Susanta.
Hi, Susanta.
hello. Hi. My question is around machine learning. I just wanted to get your perspective around how much it is the tools or programs that that organizations will have to invest in, or use of the existing applications like Microsoft to tune and configure correctly to meet the organization requirements. So what is the dimension? I mean, do organizations will have, you know, have to invest all the time new program, new tools to make it much more machine learning oriented? Or can we actually configure existing applications? But like, I mean, Microsoft is a bit more advanced application or system to use. So what is your perspective?
I think there's benefits to using off-the-shelf tools. I think they are configurable. I think they'll always be limited to the various different inbuilt applications and systems that they have. There are many free tools out there. So as long as you've got a data scientist or somebody who knows how to use these tools, you can do machine learning for free very easily. So I guess the answer is, yes, you can configure tools to do some of this in a limited scope. However, you know, there are plenty of good tools out there that are quite easy to use, that are free, open source, that will give you the answers that you want. Chitvan?
Yeah, I mean, I'll echo what you've said there, Jamie, and I definitely think there's different ways of going about implementing machine learning in your organization. And I think, you know, lowest cost of entry really is the tooling by using open source where you can. I mean, even the big organizations, they're leveraging some of the open source technologies to build the tooling they've built. You know, TensorFlow, using character recognition, computer vision libraries, all of them in Python to kind of develop the software. And so what you'll find is the difference is they've had a lot of investment into building up the source data. So while you know, the machine learning side of it is complex. I don't believe that's the most expensive part of getting into doing all of this stuff. The most expensive part is typically getting the data to build a reliable machine learning model. The other things you can also do is, depending on the use case, I mean, I'll give you an example of more recently. We're working with a client, and not in fin crime space, but we're working with a client that's looking to do some audio to speech text stuff, which we can then start diving deeper into for making sure that the right conversation was had between the client and the staff member. And we aren't going to go and invest in building a whole, you know, machine learning capability around turning audio to text, but we can use third-party services. So for example, you know, all the three big cloud providers have really strong speech to text capability. So by using their data, you know, what data they've built, we can actually get a much more reliable outcome. We could have gone down and used free libraries to do it all, but to build up the data to actually have, you know, a strong enough data set to convert audio to text, that's just far too expensive.
Thanks, Chitvan. So I can see we've got a good question here, and I'm really glad it's for you, Chitvan, because this one's a toughie. Auditing machine learning, if you get stuck, I'll help you. Auditing machine learning using machine learning is an interesting concept. It is indeed.
Yeah.
Has it been put into practice by anyone yet?
I'm sure there it has been, because we're currently in conversations with a few of our clients who are looking at auditing a lot of it. A key topic that tends to come out of auditing machine learning is ethics. Definitely is a space where we make sure that the data bias, the kind of controls put into place to make sure the machine learning model doesn't go and make decisions that might be contrary to its intent, have been put in. I mean, the key thing with auditing machine learning is the guide rails put around it, you know, augmenting it with QA processes, augmenting it with the explainable AI that I mentioned earlier, monitoring the parameters that are coming out and none of them are going outside of thresholds is really, really important. I mean, one of my colleagues, Stephen Thompson and Tim Clifton Wright, give an interesting story of a large bank where they had and another large bank where they had AI viewing a lot of their trading, and they caused a flash crash because those AIs were built on basically the same approaches, which meant that the second they saw a particular trend, they both started in the same activity, which caused that particular stock, I believe, to completely dive in a matter of seconds. And they were able to put a circuit breaker in that killed it within like 15 minutes, but that was well after the damage had been done, right? So understanding what the AI's intent is kind of what the audit must be all about. And then being able to say, you know, are we doing the proper monitoring exercises to in the business to make sure that the AI doesn't go off and go in extremes because of data inputs or bias that might be introduced that we haven't tested for exactly. Jamie, anything more to add to that?
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Chitvan. So in answer to the question, I've seen plenty of organizations are now the big organizations using machine learning to do audits. I've never seen an organization as yet use machine learning to audit machine learning, although, as we said before, I think it'll come. What we do have is we have a relatively defined framework that we've been working with a tier one retail bank to produce an RCM effectively to help audit machine learning. And that looks at two elements. A big element, of course, is the ethics. A big element, of course, is the governance. And my personal view is, when it comes to machine learning, it's about the data and how it's being used. So it should be aligned to your data governance, data management practices. And thirdly, and in a way most importantly, it's about the maths. So it's making sure that good data science processes have been followed, that we've picked the right model for the job, and that for the data scientists don't like this term, they probably use the word validation, but we've tested it properly essentially before we put it into production, and we continue to review it. So we have a defined framework that can help. And if there's any more questions, do address them for Chitvan. That's really helpful. Thank you.
And I'll just pass them halfway through to Jamie to finish off in case I ramble too much.
So while we wait for questions, I've put the case study slide up where we've been helping a number of our clients, and we're still helping many of our clients with the basics. A lot of this conversation is about the future. Chitvan, do you want to talk us through where you've helped some of our clients with filter effectiveness testing, if that's okay? And just for those on the call, filter effectiveness testing is sanctions testing, for example. So it's creating a dummy file to run through your filter. You fuzzy some of the terms up and you see if you get any alerts. And of course, it's up to your risk appetite how many misspellings you accept. Go on, Chitvan.
Yeah. So while not specifically around, machine learning, it's something that we are helping a lot of our clients get right through our audits. This, a common one that we do, and I'm not, I guess, I mean, like in terms of a case study, so is where we've looked at a client and their ability to pick up from at least two or three different lists. So there are two or three different list publishers out there. So OFAC, HMT, and I can't remember the other one. I remind me the Australian one, Jamie, I think is
DFAT.
DFAT. Yeah, where they published lists, and what we were making sure was in their filter testing process, are they indeed picking up every single hit possible from those lists, and are they correctly then marking the false positives as false positives? So sorry, not false positives, the true negatives. So those that are not hits, are they correctly marking as not hits as well? So what we did was we took the list from those three different agencies and put them through as a perfect data set. We also then fuzzified a large number of them as well. So fuzzification is the concept of minor spelling errors, right? So if I accidentally type in, my name Chitvan, but I accidentally drop the T, right? Will the filter testing still pick up my name, or at least find that I'm a close enough match? And so we did, a number of variations, controlled variations, of matches to make sure that the filter's fuzziness check, which is expected by the regulator to an extent, is actually working effectively to pick up potential matches. And there were other rules in place as well. So, for example, if date of birth was matched, so if that should increase your confidence in the hit versus, say, if the date of birth was not matched, that would reduce your confidence in the hit because that person's likely to be a different customer altogether. So we've done a lot of work around being able to help our client actually pick up instances where they have, minor. We found that, a client that had one or two differences where they didn't pick up the perfect matches, and then where their threshold outcome was actually set at a much lower level than it really should be. In one instance where we found their threshold was too high, right? So by setting it too low, you end up with far more false positives than you need. Setting it too high, you don't end up picking up all the hits that you should be. So there's trade-offs in both sides as well. So definitely an interesting space. And this is more of like the basics that need to be gotten right before you be able to move into, say, machine learning. So if you don't have a strong data set in today, then it's going to be much harder to build something that could be using machine learning to make it even more effective in the future. Yeah.
Really good question here. Couple of here, and we're running short of time. But one from Joris: stepping away from the models themselves, what would you expect to be the key risks in a platform that enables the rollout of machine learning at scale?
Do you want to kick that answer off, Jamie, first, and I'll take over?
Yeah, no worries. Yeah, that sounds good.
Give me a second to collect my thoughts.
So, the key risks in a platform that enables the rollout of machine learning at scale is it. It's a slow, the key risk is making sure that you've got it right. So if refer back to my webinar for those of you that saw it last week, there, when you're training a model and you're validating a model, training that model, making sure you've got a data set free of bias, that you've picked the right model is tough. Let's say we've got through that process and we're ready to switch it on in a production environment. Do I just let everything go through in one go and just turn it on and let it do everything? Or do I find a clever way of introducing it to make sure and get business confidence that it's working right? So think about some more intelligent chatbots, for example. We've been working with insurance companies who have been implementing chatbots because obviously, let's be honest, it's a good thing. It saves time, might infuriate a few customers, but good ones work well. They've been implementing those, and what they decided to do is they decided to take a more measured approach. Instead of letting them go directly to the customer, because actually that might increase customer dissatisfaction, it might not work. What they've been doing in the background is helping the frontline customer service operatives understand where the data comes from, and what the question answer, what the answer is. So basically, customer comes on the call, asks a question. Instead of that operator having to troll through the company intranet, etc., find the answer, they can go straight to the chatbot, type it in, up pops the answer. That's actually training, that's validating in practice, isn't it? But it's away from the customer, so it's keeping it safe. Yeah,
Yeah,
Chipman.
Jamie, before, I mean, we've got a minute to wrap up, so if and just to give you time to wrap up, I'm just going to add in, if you're interested in seeing where machine learning at scale can go possibly really wrong, there's an example of Microsoft publishing a chatbot, or I think an AI on Twitter, which kind of learned off what people tweeted at the bot itself. So to give you an example where biased data can really cause some bad outcomes, have a Google of it and you'll see that chatbot, after people being exposed to, you know, tweeting certain things at it, turn into a really racist, homophobic bot. And that's where, you know, the bias of the data can have a huge impact to the outputs of your machine learning model as well. Yeah.
And Jamie, I think that's a really good example. So the key is with all these things is use business common sense, take a soft approach if possible in implementation. What those insurance firms have done is really neat. And I'd recommend that to any organization.
Yeah, it's about having the right controls in place. So that chatbot could have been quite good if they had the right controls in place to make sure biased data was filtered out, to make sure it didn't learn from it too much, right? Anyways.
Okay, so thank you, everybody, for joining today. I hope that was useful. I think we have just about run out of time. Our contact details are on the screen, or they will be soon. Chitvan, if you can put them back up.
They are indeed. I think your presentation's off sync, that's why.
We will also be sending out a follow-up email with the notes from questions asked and recording of the meeting. And thank you to everyone who's joined us. Have a great day.